deceive about this. This word deception is planeo, which means to cause to stray, to lead astray, to lead aside from the right way. Now, that's pretty simple language there, and I think most can understand if you're being deceived, you're being led the wrong way.
Amen.
You're being led away from what's right and towards what's wrong. And we don't want to be led towards what's wrong. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So we need to stay on the right path. So he's saying if we're going to be on the right path, we're not going to be deceived. We need to realize there's some things that God will not accept as okay. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, don't stop saying amen now. But we live in a world that is full of people that say you can have situational compromise, which is to say, you know, if I'm telling a lie so I can keep somebody from getting harmed, it's okay. Well, that's not true. No. Telling lies never good. Amen?
Amen.
It always leads down further down the path to troubles. Amen?
Amen.
Telling the truth is always what?
Set you free.
Good. Yeah. It's always good to tell the truth. Does telling the truth sometimes hurt? Yes, it does.
Yeah.
But guess what? It'll set you free, just like my brother said. It'll set you free. So we need to understand that we do not need to be deceived, but we need to know what the truth is and to follow the right way. So he goes on to say, the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. Do not be deceived, neither fornicators. Now we'll stop right there. At some point, they thought it was okay, I guess, to be a fornicator. Now, what is fornication? The fornicator, which you'll find this Greek word very interesting if you listen closely to it, it's pornos. Does that sound familiar to anybody?
Yeah.
Does it kind of sound like pornography? Well, yes, that's one of the root words that we get our word pornography. Pornos, which means a man who prostitutes his body to another's lust for hire. That's one called a male prostitute. A man who indulges in unlawful sexual intercourse, a fornicator. Amen. Now, I know that's pretty plain language, but it's okay. I think we're all probably realizing we live in a world where not much is hid anymore from our children. Amen.
Amen.
It's wide open and out there. But, you know, I noticed this was interesting to me. I saw that it said, amen. You know, we try to blame what happened in the garden on Eve, but let me tell you something. It all started with a man.
Amen.
Making the wrong choice.
Amen.
What do you think would have happened in the garden if Eve had bit the forbidden fruit and Adam would have said, no ma'am, no thank you. I think I'll pass on to do it God's way.
Amen.
Hello?
Amen.
What do you think would have happened? We live in a different world. But guess what? If you go back to Genesis and you look at that, and they start pointing those fingers, hey, the woman you gave me, oh, here we go. It's right where it all started. Pointing the finger somewhere else instead of taking responsibility.
Amen.
I'm telling you these things for a reason, for where I'm going. But then what did Eve say? Oh, the serpent beguiled me or deceived me, okay? You followed somebody you shouldn't have been following in the first place.
Amen.
Amen. God said, I told you the way it's supposed to be, and the day that you eat of it, touch it, or even look at it, you're going to die. And what does the serpent say? Oh, surely you'll not die. But he went on to say, but God knows if you do this, that you'll become like him.
Amen.
You'll know the difference between good and evil. You'll know these things. Well, you know what? The serpent told a little truth there, but he told a lie.
Yeah.
Amen. Because he said, you shall surely not die.
That's right.
Yeah. And guess what? They did.
Yeah.
Amen. Yeah. They did. Guess what? Everybody since then has died except for two people that we know about.
Amen.
Enoch, who walked with God, was not. We don't know what happened to him, but he was not. And also Elijah, who was caught up in a whirlwind. Amen.
Yeah.
Some people say he's caught up in a chariot of fire. No, sorry, wrong answer. Chariot of fire divided him and Elisha.
Amen.
But he was caught up in a whirlwind. Amen.
Right.
Tornado. I'll put it in simple layman's terms. Tornado. He was caught up with tornadoes. Oh, that's some kind of trip. I imagine he was pretty dizzy the time he got to heaven. Amen. Woo! When's this thing going to stop? Amen. Kind of like my preacher. When's it going to stop? I don't know. When I get through, I guess. Amen. He goes on to say, he says, do not be deceived. Neither fornicators. They will not inherit the kingdom of God. They're not going to get there.
Amen.
Amen. They cannot inherit. And he goes on to say, nor idolaters. Idolaters. Simple this to put it in there, and alelektros, which means to worship a false god or an idol. And I really liked how this went on to say that there was all kind of feast and all kind of offerings and things going on. But it also, in the second part, said a covetous man as a worshiper of mammon. A covetous man as a worshiper of mammon. What is mammon?
Money.
Money. Worldly things. That's exactly what that means. And so, it's not just setting an idol up, you know, and saying, you know, bowing down to it or offering sacrifices to it. But it's also not just that, that's part of it, but also in worshiping the ways of the world and the money that controls the world. What does it say? The love
of money,
the love of money is what?
The
root of all evil. So, you know, if you don't love money and you love God, I think you can have a better chance of staying away from the evil.
Amen.
Amen. So, idolaters, which are idol worshipers, which could include things other than just an idol. It can include your work. Amen. It can include worshiping family, worshiping a house, worshiping a car. It can be anything. And he goes on to say, these people will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. Neither will adulterers. Maritel, which means to have been an adulterer, and metaphorically speaking, one who is faithless towards God or ungodly. Now, you never thought about that one, did you? You thought that adultery was just a man that was married to a woman going out and joining himself and having sexual relations with another man's wife or another person, as we would find out later. But no, it also means one who is faithless towards God. If you go back to the Old Testament, God said he was married to the backslider. Yeah. Which, if you research that word out, talks about the adulterer who had let themselves out to another god. And he goes on to tell us that he, you know, was not only married, but he sent his prophet out there, and Hosea, and he said, go join yourself to a prostitute. Now that sounds like crazy stuff, don't it?
Amen.
Well, not only did he go join himself to Gomer, the prostitute, but while he was married to her, she was unfaithful to him, had kids by other men, and named them all kind of different things, Ichabod and the like, which meant godless. And she prostituted herself out again and was in a house of prostitution. And God told Hosea, said, hey, Hosea, go over and get your wife, buy her back. That's pretty tough stuff.
Yeah.
Why? Because God wanted us to understand something. He wanted us to understand that we were adulterers when we went away from him and held ourselves close to something else instead of God, fell in love with something else instead of God.